social entrepreneurship. Now, we'll start from the back bench, obviously. Okay, it's obviously not the right back bench, but Mr. Okay, but anyway, Mr. Sharma will tell us what does he mean by a social entrepreneurship or social enterprise. Take a guess. Mr. Sharma, what do you think? Take a guess, yeah. What is a social, what is enterprise? Okay. So cool. Now I can say two more. Anybody? Very nice. Okay, so what's it? Is it government supposed to be doing things for the business? I mean, isn't government supposed to take care of us? That's one part of it. Isn't the business supposed to make money? That's the other part of it. Okay, so what is going on?
We have
I am downsizing without your help. You didn't even have a life here. What is this?
Siddharth, you're going to the first
one. Which earlier the kings had was to take care of us. I mean, we talk about the basic needs, whether it's food, clothing or shelter or anything like that. Somebody is supposed to take care of us. Yeah. And in a sense, whether we talk democracy or whether we talk autocracy, we are essentially saying there is some guy out there or there is some gang of people out there who we have elected or we have put into power in order to take care of us. Okay? The issue is that they are also supposed to be ensured that there are no imbalances anywhere. Okay? And take care of the general populace. The problem that happens is that although we think that governments have long-term plans, in essence we know that they only have plans till the next election. So nobody thinks about long-term. They only think about what will get them re-elected. So they are as bad or as good as the corporates in terms of being short-term focused. Okay, if they have to get elected in 5 years, the first 2 years they need to get back all the money that they have spent. Okay, and the next 3 years they need to do favors to various powerful people so that they get enough funding next time to get elected. So what happens to the general body? Along comes the business sector, and the business sector says, guys, talks to the government and says, you are in charge of all the natural resources. We are a very efficient way of dealing with things. We have a lot of expertise. Give us the natural resources, give us all the land, give us all the freebies, and we will ensure that a lot of people are employed, and therefore we can create a lot of national wealth. So theoretically, the government and the business comes together and says, we are doing good for the general body. If they were really doing good for the general body, why is there unemployment? And let's look at the statistics. Around 200 million people right now are between the age of 18 and 25. More than 80% of them are in the villages, uneducated, unemployed. By 2021, it will become 464, and by 2026, it will become 500 plus. We are arguably the youngest country in the world. And we are also the most uneducated and unemployed youngest country in this world. Figure that out. You guys belong to a rare minority, but you are not the general population. 80% of the world's wealth is consumed by 20%. 22,000 children die every day out of poverty. Across all the governments in the world who are supposed to take care of us, how come so many deaths happen? Is there something wrong? 72 million people in India not in school. 57% are girls, and by 2025, 200 million people will be in India who are unemployed. Okay, look at health statistics, look at hunger statistics. Now, one of the funny things that has happened is the following. Even in India, people are not producing food crops, people are focused on cash crops. Across the entire world, soya production is the largest production of food. And soya production is essentially used for cattle, for meat. So if you look at it, across the world, there are only 52 days of food available. In India, that number is around 102 days of food. That's the total amount of actually edible food across the world. And the only reason people are doing it is because it is a cash crop, because there's a short-term focus, because they can make a lot of money catering to the meat industry. What will happen? Three generations when India got freedom, a major population of the people were in the villages. They were relatively self-contained. You look at the urban migration. Look at that 200 or 300 million youth across the next 10 years who will be migrating to maybe 100, 200, 300 cities. Imagine the amount of pressure on the cities. Imagine the amount of unemployment in the cities. These are the people that you're inviting to your home as security guards. These are the people who invite to your home as the delivery boys. And they look at the disparity of the wealth, what they have in the villages, what they have living in the slums, and what you have. So you can imagine what is going to be your future, because you'll be living in fear, because there will be 200 million people around you of your age who don't have what you have. Take into account the fact that these slums are not well created. Take into account the fact that the politicians are using these slum people in order to create violence, because for some reason they have to get paid. They might as well get paid as being armed goons. Take into account the fact that there is enough pressure on the infrastructure because of there is pollution, there is sewage problems, because of our disease and other issues are going to happen. When the government sector and the business sector are not able to do anything, the third sector comes into play, which is called the citizen sector. The citizen sector consists of all of us, essentially the middle class. We have the wealth, okay, but we have this great ability to turn a blind eye on all these problems. We have this great ability to focus on us, our family, our problems, and leave these 200, 300 million youth alone, because they are not our problem. Some of us understand that yes, this is a problem. Some of us read what is going on. We want to do something, but the question that comes is, what can we do? Where do we start? What is to be done? Okay? The citizen sector works in four ways. The first way is the Naxal way. The government is not doing anything, overthrow the government. The second way is social activism. Let us see what is the government doing and let's monitor them. Let us see what is the business doing, let's monitor them. Let's raise a hue and cry, but let's be intellectuals and expose everything, but not do anything about it. Every time we see something happens in Delhi, we have candlelight vigils. Okay, we make a small change and then we go back into our houses. Think about it. Every time something has happened, yes, we come to social media, we scream, we rant, we rave, some change happens, or it doesn't happen, or a new thing happens, and we move on. Okay, and that's the limit of our action if we are talking about activism. The second part of activism, if you take, for example, Vinayak Sen, was he an activist? Was he a Naxal? No idea. But the point is that there is a very thin line between what the government considers you, whether you are an activist or whether you are Naxalite. So if you have even a slight touch, or if you have contacts with people who are a bit into the armed resistance, you will be automatically labeled a Naxalite instead of being labeled an activist. So you try to raise your voice, okay, you either get killed, you get shot, so therefore you are afraid of raising your voice, so you again go back and close your eyes, put blinkers and say, we don't really need to do anything. It's not our problem. The third way obviously is the NGO. People who are trying to make a change at the lowest level. But there are two issues that happen. Number one, an NGO is not scalable. An NGO works in a particular locality, but it does not have a business model by which it can replicate itself across multiple cities and say, okay, I'm doing good in one place, let me continue doing good in other places. The second issue of NGO, as you all know, they have become a via media of converting black money to white and white money to black. And some of you who are in CSR activities know very well that we outsource our CSR activity to certain NGOs which have been created for that purpose, and we choose that person who can actually divert the money back to the person who is giving them the business. So obviously NGOs now seem to have a very bad reputation. The fourth one, okay, as pointed out, social enterprise. Is it possible in some way to create some enterprise, a business model which does good to the company, okay, to the person who created it, and also does good to the general populace? Can there be a win-win where I make money and there is some benefit to the general population? And more importantly, is that model there in such a way that it can be replicated? What does replication mean? It means that I don't have to take care of it. I create a model, I create a blueprint. I put that blueprint out there in the net. Any person who wants to become a CEO can take that particular blueprint, take it to his city and replicate it. So he is in charge of that city, he is doing something in that particular locality. So I am not in control of all the people. I just create a model and I allow it to be replicated across the world. And I'll give you examples of that. The first of these obviously came, and most of you are aware of the microfinance phenomena, okay, in Bangladesh. 1970, we had the cyclone called Bola, which devastated around 500,000 Bangladeshis. 1971, we had the War of Independence, which killed around 1 million Bangladeshis. Because of the war and because of the devastation of the cyclone, 2 million people died of cholera, typhoid, and other such related things. 10 million people migrated to India. That was the situation in 1971-1972, when the World Bank, UN, etc. decided that we have to go to Bangladesh and fix this problem. So the standard methodology that the World Bank / the UN guys do is they have these high-powered, well-paid consultants who land up out there, team up with the government, decide that we will give you this much amount of funds and the government is the right person to do. Please remember, Mujibur Rahman had just come into power. The government had not been formed. And at that time, these guys all land up. So the reality, as it has happened with most UN projects across the world, people who have contacts got the money, and only 30% of the money actually came down to the real population. 70% of the money was siphoned off. Muhammad Yunus was a professor of finance in Princeton. He was a Bangladeshi. He decided that there has to be a better model. And he came up with a microfinance model, which was based on the following thing. Number one, Bangladeshis are not idiots. UN does not have the intellectual ability, that they can't decide that they are the only smart people in the world. Bangladeshi is smart enough. Okay, that was one basic premise. Second one, we are not just talking about poverty. We are not here for handouts. They give us some money so that we can do something. We are talking about our dignity. We want to create labor. Number three, you can decide that you don't want to give us the money, because all money comes with conditions. Okay, but if you do give us the money, you cannot manage us, we will manage ourselves. When they came up with this particular phenomenon, the UN said, we cannot give you money, we give money only to the government, okay, and we will tell you how you are going to be used. So therefore, Muhammad Yunus went back to the US, collected a certain amount of money, came back, and he started a microfinance movement. So he started what is called the Grameen Bank. And simultaneously, another gentleman created the BRAC. Both of them had the same model. Yeah? When we give loans, and most of you have asked for loans, they ask for all the paperwork, they want all the collateral, etc., etc. But when we are talking about loans at the lowest level, $200 worth, okay, and if there are a group of people in a village who know each other, and they are vouching for each other, and they ensure that the person to whom the loan has been given repays that loan, then you do not need physical collateral. That was the basic model. Yeah? We take the loans, we collectively vouch for the loans, we disperse the loans at the lowest level, and we ensure that the payment comes back. Other things that they did, an NGO for example, or any other social sector organization do not have statistics. They do not have any benchmarks to measure whether they are doing well or not. For the first time, for every money, every rupiah that was disbursed, they had a pretty good idea what loan was guaranteed and repaid, what child was educated, where every package of oral rehydration tablets were there. Their data was perfect. So they ran a social enterprise like an organization having the benchmarks of corporate organizations. Microfinance has now become a very in thing even in India. I'll give you another example, and I'm associated with this guy. We all know that the big cities are where the KPOs are. But we also realize that there are tier 2 and tier 3 cities where there are a lot of people who are employed, especially women, who have been asked to come back and not stay in the big bad city. They are employed, I mean they are educated, but they are not employed. So the model is the following. Anand is a guy who has been in this IT industry for the last 30 odd years. He knows where to get business. So he gets business from one customer. He goes to a particular town, say like Raipur. He finds a CEO out there. He tells him, you set up. I will bring you the business. You provide the employment. And you give me 25% of the profits. Only one customer. He goes to another town, finds another CEO, gives him another customer. He goes to a third town, finds the CEO, gives him another customer. So essentially, and he has the rules very clear, 50% of the workforce has to be women, 20% of the workforce have to be differently enabled. The CEO has to negotiate with the largest grocery shop around for better discounts for the people. So all the money that goes to that particular town stays in that town. So the GDP of the entire town goes up. And he is replicating this across all tier 2 cities in India. We all know about Ella Bhatt, Self-Employed Women's Association. Okay. The members are women. They are not salaried. You know that the unorganized sector in India has absolutely no insurance. Women particularly are the ones, even here in Bangalore, I see that. The guys are the guys who sit and drink tea. The same color, different temperature. Yeah? The women are the ones who work. Do we understand this point? The same thing is happening all over India. Okay? Ella Bhatt, sorry. She, yeah, okay. Okay, she actually organized a complete union of such self-employed women. Okay, they pay a membership, that is the only revenue model. But they ensure that child care services are provided. They ensure, okay, that the women are educated. They ensure that the women have their livelihood. They ensure that the men folk are not seizing the money that the women are earning. And there are 10 accountable units that they have. And look at these numbers. They have numbers on how many members have employed. They have numbers as to whether their income has increased. They have numbers whether they have become self-reliant. They have numbers whether they have obtained food and nutrition, whether their health is safeguarded, whether they have child care, whether they have houses, and this last one. Do they have identity cards? Do they have cattle? And do they have share of cooperatives in their own name, not in their husband's, not in their father's name? They are ensuring that the women are self-contained and they have rights. Sunmoksha is another organization that I am associated with. It provides solar power to the villages. Now, instead of providing, what we do is every unit, every house has its own solar electricity. They create solar farms, okay, and that is for the entire village. The village dig, the village set up the lines, the village create connectivity to their houses, okay. The village people are trained because when they set up the farms, they are trained in electrical engineering, they are trained in mechanical engineering, they maintain it. The village collectively decides how they are going to charge. They even have a prepaid scheme, they have a postpaid scheme. They can set it up in such a way that electricity will come out at a particular time, it will go down at a particular time, it will be in this room at a particular time, it will not be in this room at a particular time. Everything is metered. Are we understanding this point? Okay, now, what my friend does is that each of these electric meters are connected through a board, through a SIM card to the internet. And all control is done of these boards through his website. So for each village, he can open up an entire map of India and he can show you all the villages, how they are electrified, who is using what power consumption, right down to the lowest level, to every bulb in every village. Okay, now, he is not doing it. He creates a model, he has a blueprint, he takes to the sarpanch. The sarpanch decides that we will provide electricity. Okay, he sets it up for them and he starts charging for every meter that has been installed, a fixed amount every year. That is his business model. Think about it, he does not have to do anything. He is just monitoring centrally from a website. All the SIM cards are connected. Every village monitors and runs its own power supply. We are now debating a different problem that is happening. Somewhere in Orissa, in the middle of a sanctuary, a particular village is there, which was our first village, and they now have electricity. And with dowry, they had all got television sets, which were lying unused for the last 10 odd years, and suddenly these television sets have come on. Now people are watching the soap operas. People are seeing how the world lives, and there is now a social movement that is happening where people are now dissatisfied with their state in the village and they now want to migrate out of the village. Okay, so we are feeling a lot responsible that have we broken the social fabric in such a way, okay, that we have disrupted what was a harmonious village and we have created more problems because we brought electricity into the village. The other part of it, the same electricity is being used now for pumps in order to provide water, irrigation, etc. So everybody's standard of living is going up because now they all have water. They also have cold storage. So for example, what happens with the tomato guys out here when suddenly there is a surfeit of tomatoes, okay, the prices go down and the farmers don't go and get anything. Now these villages have cold storage where they are storing the vegetables and the fruit for a better time so that they get better rates. So therefore, the overall wealth of each village is going up just because we have provided solar electricity. Sutra, Fab India. Okay, so their idea is they get the stuff directly from the weavers. Okay, and all they have taken care, they have got rid of all the middlemen and they give back all the proceeds directly to the weavers. Similarly, there is another organization called Conserve India, which is using plastic to create handbags, sell handbags. Again, these are all replicable models. Please understand a very basic difference between corporate India and social enterprise. Corporate India focuses on scale. One place, the larger economies. Social enterprise focuses on replicability. One unit size replicable across multiple locations across India so that overall the national wealth of each of the region goes up. That is a very basic difference. The second basic difference is there is not one CEO who is in charge of everything that is happening in India. There are local CEOs, there are local entrepreneurs who are taking this particular model, using it to create wealth in that local area and giving a percentage cut back to the person who has the business idea. If you have more than not 10 years of corporate expertise, most of you have been corporate servants, most of you have helped move funds generated in India to outside India. Those in the financial services, you know your bosses are outside India and they take the profits. The rest of the guys, all the money is going to China. So the question is, when Mr. Modi, and I'm not a BJP fan by the way, okay, so just in case you guys think that this is one of those rhetorics, when he talks about Make in India, it's very clear. A, we need to provide employment to the youth. Agriculture is primarily dead because until there is electricity, we cannot control water. Weather patterns are so bad that most of the farmers out here are saying, you take our land and do whatever you want with it. Don't tell us what to do with it. Or a builder will come and buy our land. But we cannot take the risk of creating food because it's not worth it. And the answer is very simple, it's not worth it because they have no water, they have no control over the weather. So if agriculture is dead and 80% of the youth is sitting in the villages, if you are not creating manufacturing setups in those villages, they will all come to your town. They will all come to Bangalore or whichever city that you are in and they will create those slums, they will create unemployment, they will create pressure. So you have a choice. Either you can sit there, watch TV, stay afraid, protect yourself, trust nobody, blame the government, blame the environment, and give gyan on social media. I see a lot of you giving a lot of gyan. Or look for needs. Things that have not been done as yet. Electricity, power, hunger, employment, these are all basic needs. What can you do? Create employment. Okay? More importantly, educate people. Create entrepreneurship. Now, this is a very interesting thing. Our educational system has been created by the British in order to create an army of servants. And we are perpetuating that. The government is not very keen on creating entrepreneurs. People who have become entrepreneurs have really fought against tremendous odds in order to become entrepreneurs. But unfortunately, the future of this country is only if you become entrepreneurs. And that is what you guys, now that you are old enough, have to start thinking about.